right, if everyone can make their way to their seats. Awesome. Well, my name is Haley Jones, and I'm a development officer here at the Foundation. And I have the distinct pleasure of introducing you to our next speaker. Our next speaker is someone who has dedicated his career to advancing the cause of freedom and protecting human dignity. His important work has informed the policies that President Reagan used to defeat Soviet communism, freeing millions of people throughout the world. Dr. Lenczowski is the founder and president of the Institute of World Politics, a graduate school for national security and international affairs in Washington, D.C. He served as President Reagan's principal Soviet affairs advisor at the National Security Council. Before that, he served at the State Department as special advisor to the Undersecretary for Political Affairs. Dr. Lenczowski is an expert on issues of national security, violent extremism, and Russian politics. He has testified numerous times before Congress and has appeared on national television programs, including American Interests and CNN's Crossfire, as well as the Fox News Channel. He has authored several books on foreign affairs and most recently, Full Spectrum Diplomacy and Grand Strategy, about reforming the structure and culture of U.S. foreign policy. One of the reasons we at Young America's Foundation so appreciate Dr. Lenczowski is his strong passion for engaging and developing young people. His work at the Institute for World Politics is not simply about forming future national security professionals, but future moral leaders. Please join me in welcoming Dr. John Lenczowski.
Thank you, Haley. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a real pleasure to be here. I am a huge fan of the Young Americas Foundation, and I think that the organization has been rendering enormous service to this country for many years. And you all are very lucky to be here, and I wish that I could have been at a conference like this when I was your age. I would like to, I was asked to cover a lot of territory this afternoon, and I don't know really how I'm going to do it. I have to cover things that address domestic political issues as well as international affairs, and I have to link them somehow. So I'm going to give it a try, and please bear with me. I'd like to share with you, first of all, some thoughts about alternative political systems, and particularly how totalitarian systems clash both philosophically and ultimately geostrategically with systems characterized by freedom. In recent years, socialism has become more popular, especially among the younger generation in the West. And communism has also enjoyed a season of rehabilitation. Now, over 50% of millennials, according to a recent poll, say that they would prefer to live under either socialism or communism. This astonishing fact is enormously distressing to somebody like me, who has studied socialism for most of his life and its harmful effects. Let me review just a few of these. First of all, there are basically three variants of socialism. There's international socialism, which is communism. There's national socialism, which is Nazism. And then there is democratic socialism. The first two, of course, are totalitarian systems. In the 20th century alone, communist regimes killed more of their own people than were killed by all of the wars of that bloodiest of centuries in human history. Communism killed more people and more of their own people than the wars killed, okay? The Soviet Union killed probably between 30 and 50 million of its own people, probably around 40 million. China killed, the Chinese communist regime killed probably between 50 and 100 million, real hard to say. The conservative estimate documented in a famous book, it's called The Black Book of Communism, done by a bunch of French left-wing intellectuals, estimated that communism is responsible for the deaths of at least 100 million people. Then, of course, there's the Gulag Archipelago, the Soviet system of slave labor camps, which includes women's and children's camps, the death camps, and the psychiatric prisons, which where psychiatry was abused in order to punish and to defang prisoners of conscience. They would be given psychotropic drugs to chemically lobotomize them in order to deprive them of their will to resist. I have passed out to you, and I don't know if you've seen it, in your readings, a map of the Gulag Archipelago. I don't know if you've actually looked at this map as yet. I don't know where it is in it, but all of those dots constitute on that map. Has anybody seen it yet? Is it there? You found it. It's there. Okay, good. Each one of those dots is a different slave labor camp, prison, or psychiatric clinic. And some of those dots may represent 10 dots. In Moscow City alone, there were 30 facilities that were part of the Gulag system. In China, there exists the Lao Gai. Does anybody in this room know what the Lao Gai is? Anybody heard of it? This is the, and you live in the world of the super information superhighway, and none of you have heard of the Lao Gai. The Lao Gai is the Chinese system of slave labor camps, where millions of people are doing slavery today as we sit here in wonderful America. And nobody knows about it. Now, there are lots of reasons why. I can talk about that. A lot of it has to do with the corruption of our media, where major media like the New York Times and the Washington Post take millions of dollars from Beijing's propaganda ministry in order to publish a supplement called China Watch, which is a propaganda supplement. And those newspapers that are both money-losing operations don't want to inform you about things that would make Beijing unhappy. So they censor themselves, and nobody knows about realities like the Lao Gai. You know about it now. These types of political systems are run by Communist Party dictatorships that rule without the consent of the governed. In all cases of communist regimes, the communist parties have seized power by conspiracy, by deception, by incremental means, and ultimately by ruthlessness and the use of force. Because such regimes are illegitimate, they have a huge fear of their own people, and therefore they have an internal security problem. Hence, they set up a pervasive internal security system and these systems are just beyond the scope of the American imagination. They involve, first of all, the control of borders, the control of all internal travel, a monopoly of communications, of information, a monopoly of all book publishing, of all education, a monopoly of all entertainment, complete control of the economy, including decisions of what gets produced and how it's distributed, and who gets placed in what kind of jobs. There's the whole system of informants. The informants are everywhere. In East Germany, in communist East Germany, where we have accurate records, a full 25% of the population were secret informants to the secret police. 25%. That means if you were living in East Germany today, somebody in your family, somebody, one of your relatives, would be, and maybe more, would be informants to the secret police, and unknown to most of the members of the family. Internal travel, control of internal travel, Americans don't have a clue about this. In the USSR, it was harder to travel from one town to another than it was to escape from the entire system of slave labor camps, from any one of those camps. I know a Ukrainian religious lay activist who was arrested for his religious activities. He was sent to one of the gulag camps. He managed to escape, and with forged documents, he was able to stay at large for about 2 months. Then he was recaptured, sent back to another camp. He escaped from there, but was at large only a couple of weeks. Well, he did it again and again and again and again. Altogether, he escaped and was recaptured 10 times. He was brought to the watchtower, the highest watchtower of the most high security camp in the entire Gulag system, and was defiantly greeted there by the warden of that camp, who said, "See here, Mr. Terelia, you will never escape from this camp." And Mr. Terelia told me and a couple of our friends, "The fool should have never brought me up there, because I never would have escaped if I hadn't had a good view of the layout of the camp." But he said it was harder to travel from one town to another in an unauthorized fashion without having something like a half a dozen documents in order, including an internal passport, your draft card, your trade union card, a residency card, and one or two other things. And if you wanted to do it in an unauthorized fashion, you had to have forged documents, which isn't always an easy matter. Then on top of all of this, you've got the system of ideological propaganda. And this served as the vehicle of thought control, speech control, and ultimately behavior control. This system of ideology and ideological propaganda was like a drum beating for soldiers marching. Why do soldiers march? In order to beat the independence out of them, in order to make them conform, in order to make them follow orders, or else the military will not work. And so if somebody isn't marching properly, he can easily be identified by the sergeant and removed and disciplined. This is how totalitarian systems work. This is what political correctness is. And it was Lenin who invented political correctness for all practical purposes. The great Russian author, novelist, and historian Alexander Solzhenitsyn said that the worst thing about living under communism was not the privations of daily life, like, for example, standing for 4 hours in line to get a tube of toothpaste and having to do this kind of thing almost every day. And that was the reality of it, because the communist system never produced consumer goods. It only produced military goods that worked. And there were persistent shortages. But that wasn't the problem, just these awful privations. He said the real problem of living under communism was the steady, the daily force feeding of a steady diet of lies. And he said that when the lie fastens its claws around your neck, it isn't just a political act to make you conform. It is an attack on your very human dignity. And the very act of telling the truth is not only a political act, it is the act of reclaiming your human dignity. And this is what was required in order, ultimately, to overthrow the Soviet system. You can talk about all the material things that we did, and I worked on that strategy when I was in the government. We did a military buildup. We developed strategic defenses to trump their ballistic missile force. We supported the anti-communist resistance in Afghanistan and in Central America, and we did a lot. We lowered the oil prices so that they would be deprived of all of the hard currency earnings that they got from selling their oil and gas. But none of that explained how a million people could take to the streets in Moscow and demand radical political change. It required moral courage on the part of millions of people inside the Soviet Empire in order to come and demonstrate and demand that change. And so it involved a principal element of that methodology was telling the truth and getting through just one day without repeating the official lies. Now, this is just scratching the surface of the enormity of the human suffering under communism. So what was the basis of such a system? I'd like to examine some of the philosophical premises, because there are philosophical premises that underlie every political system one way or another. And I want to show you and talk about how those premises are at odds with Christian and very specifically Catholic social teachings. The first thing to remember is that the philosophical root of totalitarian socialism is materialism, the denial of the existence of God and the denial of anything spiritual. Lenin wrote a whole book about this. It was called Monism and Imperial Criticism. It's a whole book about epistemology, which is a theory of knowledge. And he said that, and this was such an important thing, because he basically said one cannot know anything unless that thing is a direct reflection of material reality. There is no God because there is no material manifestation of God as far as he was concerned. So the communist therefore says that because there is no God, it is human reason that is the creative intelligence of the universe. Well, from this it follows that there is no such thing as objective moral standards, standards of right and wrong, because there is no divine law. There is no natural law that derives from the divine law. And what is the natural law? It's the law of decent behavior, of what's right and wrong, that is written on the human heart. And it can come from only one of two places. It can either come from God, or it can somehow inhere in nature. And how that can be the case, I don't know. Some people believe that moral standards can somehow derive from nature. It's never been properly explained to me. The only way I can imagine moral standards coming from anywhere is that they've been infused into our hearts by some kind of higher moral intelligence, which is what we call God. So, if there are no objective moral standards, then moral standards are a relative matter. That's what moral relativism is. It's where you reject the objective standards, and what's right and wrong is simply a matter of your own personal preference. So I have my moral code, you have yours, I'm okay, you're okay. Just please don't be judgmental about it. Don't judge me for my moral standards, and I won't judge you, and then we'll be happy. Now, if my moral standards somehow are something that end up judging you, oh, then I'm a real sinner. That's the worst sin, is just judgmentalism. So moral relativism, where moral standards are a matter of personal preference, is the ultimate foundation of these types of collectivist totalitarian systems. Now, how in these kinds of systems does one establish the moral standards of society if there are no objective ones? Well, in a democracy, like a social democracy, for example, they emerge as the collectivity of everybody's personal preferences, which seems reasonable enough. But that means, in principle, that they are a matter of power struggle. Who has got the biggest number of votes? And you know, sometimes majorities can become tyrannical. You've probably heard of the expression a tyranny of the majority. It's where majorities can sometimes deny minorities their inalienable rights. And so that's, but the fundamental principle here is that even if it's the biggest number of votes, so to speak, the collectivity of personal preferences, it's really a matter of power struggle. That logic means that if you really get down to brass tacks, moral standards are really established by the people with the biggest guns and the greatest will to use them. And what we call this, and this is when you so roundly reject the existence of a divinely ordained natural law, you in effect are subscribing to the doctrine of might makes right. The might that you have to be able to enforce your standards as opposed to those of the divinely ordained natural law. Lenin articulates the classic formulation of communist morality in his speech to the youth leagues, and that's the top reading that you have there. The argument that he makes appears in the second half of that speech, but that speech was required reading for every Soviet schoolchild, and they probably read it in some of the other communist countries as well. He says in there that there is no such thing as objective moral standards. He said, the notion of objective moral standards is a bourgeois prejudice. And he then declares that what is good is that which helps the communist revolution, and what is evil is that which hinders the revolution. So what helps or what hinders is entirely a matter of the party's judgment. Is it good or evil to blow up a busload of innocent school children? Well, the answer to that question is it all depends. If you blow up that school bus and the effect of it is that the society reacts and creates an almost a police state-like atmosphere in order to create security on all the buses and all the airplanes and all the trains and going into the public buildings and everything, well, you know, maybe people will get so alienated from a police state type of an atmosphere that it will enhance their alienation from society in general and enhance their revolutionary consciousness. This makes it good for the revolution. But on the other hand, if blowing up that school bus is something that simply has the effect of waking up a sleeping giant of an otherwise anesthetized society, then maybe that's bad for the revolution because now society as a whole is going to be more vigilant against revolutionary activity. So the answer is, so therefore, you know, blowing up a school bus is not intrinsically evil. It could be good, it could be bad, it all depends upon how it affects the revolution. This is a contingent morality. This is how a morality ceases to have any objective standard. So the materialist worldview leads the communist to identify as the economy, as the foundation for everything in human life. Because it's the economy has to do with the production of goods and services that sustain life. And it's for this reason that the communist materialist philosophy calls the economy the base. Sometimes the jargon calls it the basis. And everything else in society, the political system, the legal system, the culture, religion, everything else rests upon that economic base. That is how Marxism-Leninism works. And all of that other stuff, the political, legal system, et cetera, is called the superstructure, which rests upon the base. If you change the base, then that will end up changing the superstructure. So since the communist sees the world's economic arrangements as unjust and creating an inequality arising from the exploitation of workers by the owners of the means of production, the communist concludes that the problem is private property. And so once private property is eliminated, the communist says, and the property becomes owned by everybody rather than by just one, you know, ruling class, there will be no more basis for the formation of a class of property owners to exploit and oppress the workers. Well, the problem here is that the socialist communist attack on private property is directly at odds with Christian doctrine. Two of the Ten Commandments pertain directly to private property. Thou shalt not steal, and thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's goods. These commandments implicitly recognize the legitimacy of private property. What about one of the seven deadly sins, envy? Isn't this a sin precisely because of the recognition of the legitimacy of private ownership? There's a great papal encyclical, of which you should be aware. Everybody should read it here, and I'm sorry I didn't pass this one out, but do make a note of it. It's called Rerum Novarum. Rerum Novarum, R-E-R-U-M, and then N-O-V-A-R-U-M. It was written at the end of the 19th century by Pope Leo XIII. And this encyclical explicitly explains how private property is a natural human right. It is a thing, he explains, that distinguishes man from animals, because man can possess something that he can use over and over again, whereas animals do not have that same capability. Pope Leo was called the workers' pope, and he argues that owners of businesses have to respect the dignity of those workers. They have to treat them well and pay them fairly. He also argues that workers, in turn, have to respect the risks that owners take to establish and maintain their businesses, and the hard work that they do, which ultimately gives their employees the opportunity to have dignified work themselves. In so doing, he's not only in making these two arguments, he's representing the interests and the dignity of workers, but he is squarely attacking socialism. You should also be aware of one of the major papal encyclicals attacking atheistic communism, but this one here is one of the really great classics. Now, remember, the communist says that there is no God, and therefore human reason is the creative intelligence of the universe. Well, in light of this, the communist believes that it is possible to perfect human nature. And underlying this view is the assumption that there is no immutable human nature, that man is an empty vessel whose character is determined solely by his environment. And if that's so, then human nature can be perfected by some kind of political, economic, or social engineering. This whole idea of the malleability of human nature was something that emerged in the 18th century Enlightenment and was brought to its full logical conclusion by the totalitarian socialist ideologies of Nazism and communism. The assumption about the perfectibility of man is central to every brand of socialism. The Nazis wanted to perfect man through eugenics, to create a master race. Eugenics continues to be popular here in the United States and in the West. The Congress just gave Planned Parenthood $500 million. And what's Planned Parenthood? Well, you know, its founder, Margaret Sanger, was a strong believer in eugenics. And she sought to use contraception and ultimately abortion as a method to eliminate, to diminish and to eliminate what she deemed to be the inferior races, particularly Afro-Americans. And so today, Planned Parenthood sets up a disproportionate number of its offices in minority, in the neighborhoods of racial minorities, and abortion in America today kills a full 50% of all black babies in the womb. 50% of all of them. So that's eugenics. Oh, by the way, what about the kids with Down syndrome? Well, apparently we don't really like to have them around, right? So we kill all of them. Eugenics, we're going to create a master race. Nazi ideology is alive and well, parts of it here in our own country. Meanwhile, communists work to create what they call the new Soviet man, or just sometimes it's just the new man, the new communist man. They're going to perfect man on this earth, and they're going to do it by getting rid of private property. Even democratic socialists harbor the assumption that human nature can be made better, and they seek to pursue that project with the power of the state. In contrast, Christian doctrine explicitly recognizes that there is such a thing as human nature, that it is a moral nature, and that the essence of human life is moral choice, and that part of that nature is characterized by original sin. You've heard of it. Where man must be communist jamming. Man, original sin, okay? And what's that? Where man will always be subject to the temptation to do the wrong thing. Christian doctrine thus recognizes that although society can work to create a better moral ecology, we're never going to make everybody into saints on a mass scale through social engineering. Now, you know, what is creating a better moral ecology? Well, when I was growing up, it was very hard to gain access to pornography. Today, anybody can with just a click of a mouse. Anybody can. And many of you may have been exposed to it. Well, let me just say, if you've never read about it or thought about it, pornography is one of the most corrosive things that can happen in human life. It destroys families. I have two longtime friends, married for many years, and it was just discovered, and the wife just discovered that the husband was basically addicted to pornography, and their marriage is destroyed right now. And you want to destroy the family? You know, go look at pornography. Want to destroy your future sex life? Look at pornography. You will be desensitized. Pornography helps make you bored. It helps make you bored because there you can't find any greater excitement. And so we could get rid of it. And society would be a lot healthier. Families would be a lot healthier. And your sex lives would be a lot better, too. Anyway, but you're not going to make everybody into a saint by doing that. You're improving the moral ecology, but you're not going to solve the fundamental problem of human nature, where original sin is a reality of the human condition. So, you know, how do people become saints? Not through social, political, or economic engineering. They become saints by returning God's love for them and by struggling individually against the worst angels of their nature. All right. Again, since the communist sees human reason as the creative intelligence of the universe, and since the communist believes that the end justifies the means, that the end, the revolution, morally justifies any means to get it, right? Because what's good is that which helps the revolution. He concludes that to make an omelet, you've got to break a few eggs. And so, because the ruling, property-owning, oppressor class has so many interests in the existing system, they will not politely step out of the way. So they have to be eliminated. And this explains the mass murder in one communist country after another. Now, just so that this isn't a matter of theory, because when you start talking about killing 100 million people, this becomes a statistic rather than actual human flesh and blood. So let me just tell you, my own mother, when she was in her 20s, was arrested by the Soviet secret police just a week or two after the Nazi blitzkrieg the blitzkrieg of Poland that started World War II. Just before that, Hitler and Stalin had signed the famous Stalin-Hitler Pact, otherwise known as the Nazi-Soviet Pact, otherwise known as the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact. And 1 week after the Nazis invaded Poland, the Soviets invaded from the other side. Well, my mom was arrested by the NKVD, which was the secret police and intelligence service. Why? What did she do? Well, she had a college education. And her father was a businessman. So therefore, she was a class enemy. And the communists had to eliminate class enemies. And that's what they did. And they deported millions of people like this into the Gulag system. And the Nazis tried to eliminate the same kind of people. It happens, my grandparents, my father's parents, Polish Catholics, were killed in Nazi concentration camps. You hear about the Jews getting killed. Well, there were 3 million Poles that were killed during that time. So this is real. It's real. So you've got to break a few eggs if you want to make an omelet. Meanwhile, democratic socialists, they will reject these extreme measures. But they promote a concept of social justice that rests on equality of result and income redistributionism. And this is based on a concept of the power of the state and the coercive power of the state and what I believe is a false concept of charity. Is it charitable to tell somebody that they've got to pay more and more taxes? And if you don't pay them, you go to jail. That's the coercive power of the state. So that those taxes can be used to take care of poor people? Is that charity? Well, charity is when you've got it in your heart to take care of a poor person. When you've got it in your heart. Not when somebody has taken you, grabbed you by the ankles, flipped you upside down, and shaken the coins out of your pockets. That's not charity. Now, this is using the coercive power, taxation power of a centralized state. And it rests in practice on the rejection of a classic element of Catholic social teaching, which is called the principle of subsidiarity. I gather that you may have discussed this a little bit already. But in sum, the principle of subsidiarity is one which dictates that you try to solve the problems of society as close to where the problems reside as possible, at the local level, because that's where problems are manifest. Sometimes there is a national solution to problems that seem to exist everywhere throughout the society, but there is a huge wisdom to this principle, because ultimately, how are you going to get better citizens who are less likely to be law-abiding? How are you going to get better citizens who are more likely to be honest, who are more likely to pay their taxes rather than cheat on their taxes? How are you going to get people who are who are less likely to take drugs? You're gonna do this not because of the centralized state based in Washington, D.C. You're gonna do it because you're gonna have healthy families and you're gonna have parental love by both a mother and a father. Today, because of our welfare state and because of the rejection of the Catholic principle of subsidiarity, we have a system in this country where the almighty state has taken the place of fathers. So in the old days, I remember there was an Afro-American politician who delivered by the name of Alan Keyes, a brilliant guy with a Harvard PhD, used to run from political office from time to time up in Maryland. I remember him speaking about how in the days when there was much more racism in this country, much more discrimination against blacks, where there were Jim Crow laws and all of this kind of thing, the black family was much, much healthier than it was today. It wasn't because of that racism and so on and so forth. It's because There were, because people, the black families were intact, the people were going to church, they were living their lives, having contemplated the possibility that they just might be accountable for how they live their lives. In other words, maybe they'll be judged for how they live their lives. And if a young lady got in trouble, if she got pregnant, and without being married, well, there was no nanny state there to take care of her. So what would she do? She'd go to some relative of hers, go to her parents, go to her uncle, somebody, and say, I need help. So you got to help take care of me. And so the uncle or whoever it is will say, okay, young lady, I'll give you some help. But guess what? You're not going to let this happen again until you're married. Or you're going to go and get that guy who impregnated you, and you're going to get him to marry you and take care of you because he owes it to you. And the young lady's going to get a moral lecture from somebody whom she is appealing to for help. Well, today that doesn't happen anymore. Today what happens, because of the rejection, that is the principle of subsidiarity at work in a very practical human problem. But now what happens is the nanny state comes along, Uncle Sam comes along and says, we'll take care of you. But there's no moral lecture. There's no moral lecture. And so the young lady may go out there and get impregnated by five different men, none of whom assume the role of fathers. Fathers aren't needed anymore under this system. And one of the greatest problems, social pathologies of our society, is the total absence, not total, the pervasive absence of fatherly love and fatherly discipline. And if you don't have that, you are the social science research. Look, this is not pontification from me at this podium. This is social science research that demonstrates that young people who grow up in intact families with a mother and a father and with genuine parental love, including that kind of tough love that involves discipline and the setting of limits and the establishing of moral standards and helping the cultivation of individual consciences in the families, that is what produces law-abiding, psychologically secure, productive, good citizens for the society. But one of the biggest agendas of the radical totalitarians has been to break up the family. It's an explicit part of the whole. Look at the Communist Manifesto. Read the Communist Manifesto. Look at how many things Marx and Engels write in the Communist Manifesto that have been already enacted by our own society. Break up the family. And guess what was one of the most important elements of Marxist-Leninist revolutionary action in order to seize power in Russia? The promotion of sexual libertinism, sexual quote-unquote freedom. The complete breakdown of limits on sexual morality. And they did it to destroy the institutions of traditional Orthodox Christian Russian society. And they did it in the initial years of the Bolshevik Revolution, once they had seized power, in order to continue that process of the breakdown of those institutions, to the extent that the Bolsheviks nationalized women. I repeat, the Bolsheviks nationalized women so that if you were somebody's wife, you weren't that person's wife. You were the people's wife. You were the people's wife. Well, that's how far it got. And then they realized, once they had destroyed the old society, and the destruction of religion was central to this, by the way. In pre-revolutionary Russia, there were 750,000 churches, 750,000 in the Russian Empire. By the 1980s, there were only 7,500 left. What happened to all those churches? They turned them into warehouses, police stations, community centers, latrines, swimming pools, museums of religion and atheism. Break down religion, break down the family. And by the way, once they had seized power and consolidated it, having destroyed the institutions of the traditional institutions of traditional Russian culture, they then, in order to stop the process of revolutionary destabilization, because they had already gotten power, they restored sexual puritanism. And they took all the gays whom they could find and they threw them into the gulag. The gays were useful. They were useful during the period of sexual libertinism, where there is no such thing, where there's a complete rejection of traditional sexual mores. But once they decided to restore puritanism, oh, those people weren't useful anymore. Throw them to the slave labor camps, where they had a very low life expectancy. So the principle of subsidiarity is a very serious thing at many different levels. And the most local level for the solution of problems in our society is the family. So, of course, the breakdown of the family, which I mentioned is part of the objective of the revolutionaries, was also designed to ensure that parents don't effectively raise their children, that the state does. So take the woman out of the home, if she's going to be the principal caregiver, and then to have the children raised in daycare and in the state, in the government schools, and so on and so forth. Well, part of my brief here today is to talk a little bit about just war doctrine. How on earth do I get from all of this to just war? Well, let's remember that these systems were diametrically at odds with our systems of what we hope will still be some level of morally ordered liberty. Where our system is based on a completely different philosophical premises. Our system is based on the acknowledgement of objective moral standards, and it's also based on the recognition of the existence of the flawed nature of man. As James Madison said, if men were angels, there would be no need for governments. But men are not angels, and therefore we have to set up all of our public arrangements in this society on the basis of that fact in order to protect ourselves from the inevitable evils that will come from some people in our public life. Because everybody in power, whether they're presidents or senators or governors or legislators of some kind, judges, they're always going to be subject to the temptation to do the wrong thing. And that's why we diffuse power from federal to state to local governments. We have a separation of powers of executive, legislative, and judiciary. We have a rule of law. We have a constitutional law by which we judge our statutory laws, some of which can be unjust. And the very recognition of the fact that there can be such a thing as an unjust law is a recognition of the existence of a natural law. In our society, I don't think that our society of majority rule with inalienable minority rights cannot work logically unless those rights come from a source higher than a majority. Because majorities, remember, can be tyrannical and can deny minorities their rights. So that there has to be a higher law than that. And that's how the American system is based. We say, the founders said that our rights come from the Creator, not from the Republican Party or the Democratic Party or the Whigs or anybody else. So we ended up being under assault. The Western world and parts of the intermediate world, the Third World, were under assault from aggressive communism. And we had a Cold War that went for half a century. And a lot of people thought that You know, this war, of course, was characterized by arms races, by nuclear arms, and so on and so forth, and there was a big peace movement. And there was a hope that we would achieve peace by some kind of disarmament. Well, you know, what is it that actually achieves peace? What is peace? Some people think it's a set of psychological categories that has to do with feeling charitable or tolerant towards others, and there's an element of truth to that. But the traditional ancient Christian understanding of peace, it comes from St. Augustine, is that peace is the tranquility of order. The expression is tranquillitas ordinis, the tranquility of order. And it is a matter of creating political order. It's a matter of creating human community. And in order to get it right, it requires a couple of things. You have to be realistic about human nature in order to get peace right. You have to be realistic about the dark side of human nature and the best side of human nature. So because we know of man's potential for corruption and evil, we have to have laws, and we have to have law enforcement. You have to have the police. And internationally, you have to have armies. And they have to have weapons. And actually, most people's experience of living in peace is where governments have formed, people have established governments and authority over given territories, and they've established order within those territories. And most of humanity's experience of living in peace is where there are those established territories which are governed by a properly, legally constituted monopoly of force. And where that monopoly of force doesn't exist, such as where gangs control certain sectors of some cities, you don't have peace. Anyway, the police and armies are absolutely necessary in order to deal with the dark side of human nature. But you cannot build human community simply on the basis of the police. You build human community and you create that political order by taking also into account the good side of human nature, which is man's capacity for truth, for justice, and for that love of neighbor that even transcends the requirements of justice. You know, there's a little bumper sticker you see sometimes on the car. If you want peace, work for justice. It's true. But actually, it's only partially true. Because if you want peace, you better have an army. And if you want peace, you don't want just justice. Justice is absolutely essential for peace. But most people want more than justice. They want mercy, and they want forgiveness. If any of you drive cars, and probably most of you drive cars, if you got justice, you might not have a driver's license. What you really want is mercy, because you probably have sped before. So, political order requires all these things. And one has to keep every element of it in mind if you're trying to build that. Another thing that to recognize, during, you know, a lot of people thought, well, we just get rid of our arms, you know, all these nuclear weapons, we limit them and there'll be peace. Well, excuse me, weapons are not a cause of tensions. Weapons are a symptom of tensions. Tensions come from political concerns, and you can't have a reduction of tensions without a reduction of political concerns. In the Cold War, there were all these peace movements saying we've got to disarm ourselves, we've got to get rid of the nuclear weapons and all this stuff. Excuse me. I remember when our director of Central Intelligence was going regularly to brief Pope John Paul II in the Vatican about Soviet nuclear weapons deployments. And he was doing this at a time when the Europeans had asked us to deploy nuclear weapons that could match the Soviet weapons in the European theater in order to create a balance and a credible deterrent. And ordinarily, you'd think, oh, the Pope wants us to, just smash those swords and turn them into plowshares. Oh, yeah, except that Pope John Paul did not protest any of those efforts for the United States to deploy nuclear weapons in Europe because he got the briefing on what the Soviets were deploying. So how do you have peace? It's not by getting rid of the weapons. It's by getting rid of the concerns. And the concerns are the tyranny, the human suffering, the murders, the slave labor, and all of that of a system that was busy trying to expand itself and busy trying to replicate itself, which is a system that operates in North Korea today, and it is a system that operates in China today. In China and in Cuba and in Vietnam. This is still alive. The Lao Gai. Remember the Lao Gai. So during the Cold War, the inventor of the Soviet H-bomb, a guy named Andrei Sakharov, said to the Kremlin, the Soviet leaders, you will never have peace with the West until you have peace with your own people. And peace with your own people means respecting their human rights. There is no peace without respect for human rights. Now, I'm looking at the clock, and I don't think I have time, Kimberly, to talk about just war doctrine. And I'm sorry for going so long. But if I'm happy to take any questions, as much time you want to give me. And I can talk about just war if you want me to, but I think that would be a... Okay, terrific. Yes. Great.
Hi, my name is Paolo Rosa. I'm from Potomac Falls High School here in Sterling. And I was wondering, how do you respond to the common talking point from the liberals that no true communism has been executed yet in history?
Well, it's a complete canard. Communism has been tried in the Soviet Union, in Poland and Hungary and Czechoslovakia and Romania and Bulgaria and Albania and Yugoslav Federation and in China and in Laos and in Cambodia and in Vietnam and in Cuba and in Grenada and in Nicaragua and may I go on, Angola, okay, I mean, it goes on and on and on. And each time, they say, well, it didn't really work out so well, that wasn't the true communism. Okay, so we'll have to try it here. And so the liberal left was saying, well, gee, maybe in Cuba that's the way it'll be. It'll be good. Well, guess what? It is utopianism. The notion of the perfectibility of man is a utopian objective, and it is and this type of utopianism is central to the whole project. And the notion that it hasn't been tried, well, excuse me. What is it going to take? How many more millions of people have to be killed before yet another experiment in mass murder is going to succeed? Excuse me, this is not heaven on earth. And realism about human nature is central to a good society. And our system is based on the greatest genius proposition about America is that there is a sinful nature of man. That's the genius insight. And we build all our public arrangements around this fact. All of these socialist enterprises reject this idea. And here we have a humane society with its problems. But this is the laughter compares America to heaven when they should be comparing America to the other items on the menu. Go look at it. When I was in Berkeley, I went to Berkeley in the 1960s, okay, when they were, when the predecessors of Antifa were busy breaking the windows there, just the way they're breaking them now. And one of the leaders of the Black Panther Party was a professor there, was given a professorship. By the way, the Black Panther Party has been revealed in Soviet Party archives as having been funded by the KGB, the Soviet Secret Police and Intelligence Service. Well, this guy, his name was Eldridge Cleaver, and he decided he was going to go into exile and get a real flavor of what Marxist revolution was going to be like. And he went and lived in Algeria for a year when it was headed up by one of these third world Marxist types. And then he went to Cuba to live under, you know, a 200-proof Castroism for a year. When he came back, Eldridge Cleaver, who was a vicious Marxist revolutionary, whose part of whose methodology was to rape white women on a systematic basis as a way of getting back at the man, okay? He came back to America, he kissed the ground, he converted to Christianity, and he became a conservative Republican, okay? Go on your quest for the perfect communism. It's utopianism. That's all there is to it. Thank you.
My name is Sean McGrath. I go to Whitworth University in Washington State. I was wondering, what is a just response on the part of the U.S. to the North Korean and Chinese slave camps?
Well, I think the best response to the existence of those things, first of all, is to bear moral witness and not to censor ourselves about them. During the Cold War, and this is, by the way, a principle of communist rule, the communists rule according to the principle of the story of the emperor's new clothes, where everybody in the court, when I was talking about the steady force feeding of a daily diet of lies, everybody in the court has to say that the naked emperor is wearing beautiful clothes. And they all do so. Why? Some of them out of fear, and some of them out of loyalty to the emperor. And then there are some people maybe who just stand there silently in the court. They can't bring themselves to tell the truth, but again, out of fear. And it takes a little boy to come along and say, oh, he's the emperor's naked, to destroy the whole thing. During the Cold War, Ronald Reagan and Pope John Paul II were the equivalent of the little boy in that court. And the emperor's new clothes is how they ruled domestically, but they ruled that way internationally too, where everybody in the world had to say that the Soviet Union was wearing beautiful clothes, that it was a normal state, that it was a legitimate member of the global community of nations, when in fact it was a criminal state. It was an organized crime against humanity is what it was. But nobody would say so until Ronald Reagan came along and called them an evil empire. And when he did so, those words reverberated into the dankest corridors of the gulag. And people like Anatoly Sharansky, who now has emigrated to Israel, he's a member of the Israeli Knesset, their parliament. He was there totally demoralized. You know, and these dissidents there who want to see the truth, want to tell the truth, they're thirsting for moral witness. They're all alone. They suffer from the very psychological state that the regime wants to put them in, the state of futile resignation. Resistance is futile. And here he hears these words, evil empire, coming from the lips of Ronald Reagan, and all of a sudden he has hope. I'm not all alone. Somebody here cares about me and cares about my brothers and sisters who are suffering under all of this. Bearing moral witness is one of the most important things that can be done. And then I think that we have to work on regime change, but not by lobbing surgical strikes against their nuclear weapons. The problem is not the nuclear weapons. The problem is the genetic code, the toxic genetic code of those regimes. How do you do it? You do it the way we did it to the Soviet Union. You break their monopoly of communications and information. You break the regime's ability to atomize the society. What is atomization? It's you spray a little spray bottle, and the liquid is atomized into all of these little atoms, right? So each individual is separated from everybody else and left alone against the omnipotent state. And they can't communicate with each other because they don't know who the informant is. There's a pervasive atmosphere of mistrust. One of the things that we did was we broadcast into the Soviet Empire. And so, quick example. There was the Solidarity Movement. They went on strike in the Lenin shipyards in Poland. And whenever there's a civil disturbance in one of these states, and by the way, there are 75,000 civil disturbances in China today, every year, 75,000 a year. Whenever there's a civil disturbance in a totalitarian country, what's the first thing the police state does? It shuts down all communications to the locale. Then they go in and crush the strike, the riot, the demonstration, whatever it is. And then if people eventually learn about it, what did they learn? Well, there was a strike, but it was crushed. Resistance is futile. When the strikers in Poland went on strike, they had developed an underground line of communication somehow to the Voice of America and Radio Free Europe. And while the strike was going on, they got the fact of that strike to our broadcasters. We broadcast it to tens of millions of Polish people, and the people said, hey, there's a strike going on. Resistance isn't futile. We'll stand up along with them. If you just stick your neck out, one neck out of the crowd, they'll cut your head off. If the whole crowd stands up, then you can't cut all those heads off. And that's how 10 million people joined the Solidarity Movement overnight. And it was because we had broken their monopoly of communications and information. And when they have that capacity, then they have an incentive to communicate amongst themselves. We were bringing in mechanical printing machines. We were bringing in fax machines. We were bringing in paper. These regimes have a monopoly of paper. We're copying machines. We bring all kinds of stuff like this in order to help break that monopoly. It's the most strategic thing we can do. And I think, and moral witness to stand with them to make sure that they're not alone. No violence. 2,500 years ago, Sun Tzu, the ancient Chinese sage, in his famous book, The Art of War, said, to defeat your enemy without using force is the acme of skill. How do you do that? I'll tell you, ladies and gentlemen, the Institute of World Politics, whose brochure you have in front of you, is the only school in the nation that will teach you how to do that. Okay. Is it time? I'm getting the hook. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. And anybody wants to come and I don't know where you all are in your educations, but we're the only school in the country that teaches all the instruments of national power, all the arts of statecraft, and while teaching American founding principles and Western Greco-Roman Judeo-Christian moral philosophy and applied ethics in order to enhance moral leadership in this country. And I gave you, I hope, a little hors d'oeuvre for what we do. Thanks.